I have your attention, please? Good evening. My name is Pat Henney, and I'm the Executive Director of the Glendora Chamber of Commerce. It is with great pleasure that I call this the 44th Annual Citizen of the Year Banquet, sponsored by the Glendora Chamber, to order. I would like to introduce to you at this time the 1991-92 President of the Glendora Chamber, Robert Davis.
Thank you. On behalf of the Board of Directors, our Director, and the staff of the Chamber, I heartily welcome you, welcome all of you at the 44th Annual Citizen of the Year Banquet, where we honor those who have made Glendora the special community that we all enjoy being part of. This evening's banquet celebrates volunteers and especially sponsored by the Chamber to recognize the vital part volunteerism plays in our community. As official sponsors, it is fitting to take a moment to ask the 1991 and 92 Board of Directors to stand and be recognized. Come on, where's my board? Their important volunteer commitment to the Glendora Chamber has contributed both in the growing membership and especially in the quality and quantity of programs and projects that we have accomplished. The theme selected by tonight's honorees is teamwork, pulling together, lightening the load. As the evening progresses, you will be introduced to many special guests. But at this time, I would like to bring forward someone who needs no introduction, our Master of Ceremonies and former Citizen of the Year, Mr. Ben Bollinger.
Thank you very, very much. I am so honored to be asked to be Master of Ceremonies again this evening. I understand I was not going to be asked, but when they chose the theme, something about the load getting lighter, I was chosen. So I thought, before I get into this evening, and I would like to suggest to you this evening that a lot of this is humor. Some of you take it too seriously. The Fracasses do not have a very good sense of humor. It's hard for Jewish people to come from New York to California and laugh about it. I must also tell you that the names are much more difficult tonight than I've ever seen, so be patient with us as we go through all of the families, all right? Now, before we offend too many people, I would like to ask Tim Keene if he would come forward and give the prayer. And Tim, could you include me this evening in the prayer, because this is going to be a long, tough evening.
This is going to be a long and tough prayer, too. I'm honored to be here and privileged, and I know I'm not going to get to say anything later, so I just don't pray, you know. I speak also, and I already remember in the Coordinating Council in Glendora back in the 70s, I guess, we were having a lot of difficulty with it. I was president 2 years. That had nothing to do with it. But Ida became president, and The Coordinating Council began to grow again, and everybody knows what it is today. So that's just one of the many things that they did, and with the cooperation of Joe. So I am very pleased to be here, and I was able to pronounce everybody's name at my table.
You may be MC.
Wasn't I? Good. I get him trained. Now let us pray. O God, our merciful and loving Father, We thank you for allowing us to participate in the 44th Annual Citizen of the Year Community Banquet sponsored by the Glendora Chamber of Commerce. Bless our coming together tonight as we join together in honoring Joe and Ida Fracasse as 1991 Citizen of the Year. We ask you, Father, to help us express our thanks and gratitude to our honored guests, Joe and Ida, for the privilege of knowing and working with them. It is difficult, Father, for us to adequately express appreciation on an occasion such as this. But may the coming together of family, relatives, friends, and associates let Joe and Ida know that we are grateful for 26 years of faithful and loyal service and all that means and suggests. It is the fondest wish of all gathered here that your grace be with them and your love encompass them. Bless us all, Lord, as we celebrate and break bread here together tonight. So, Joe and Ida, whatever is beautiful, whatever is meaningful, whatever brings you happiness, that is what we all wish for you tonight. This we pray to God, the Almighty and Father of us all. Amen and shalom.
Thank you.
You're welcome. I'll take your notes.
Thank you very much. Now, before the evening festivities begin, I would like to just give you a few of the ground rules. I know that you realize that this is a sellout each year, and we have a limited space, and when the singers come in, you'll feel crowded through the evening. And we have a tremendous, I think probably the longest program I have seen in my 25 years of being associated with this. So there will be a potty break at 12:15 a.m. I have never seen a program like this in my life. Let me make a couple opening remarks before dinner, because I want everyone in this community to now just stop for a moment and think. I have never offended anyone in my lifetime. I think it's wonderful that Everett Hughes, 2 years ago, being Citizen of the Year, realized that his hip did squeak and got it replaced. Orv Mested broke his collarbone skiing. What he isn't telling anyone is where, and we won't tell that. But it seems that when you go through an evening like this, you can recall and remember past years. But this year is different. I see, for example, Odell sitting out there, and he's part of what I have to say this evening, and probably be the last time I speak to him. But as I come through the evening, I want to point something out to you, and I've written this down so that if anybody wants a copy of this, feel free afterwards to come up and I'll fax it to you. Tonight is a very special night for the city of Glendora. We actually dropped below Alasta to honor two of our outstanding citizens. Please, people, I didn't interrupt you. Yes, Ida and Joe actually live in Baja Glendora. They are the first recipients from Southern Glendora. Now, they are very proud of this accomplishment. However, Joe Nava, chairman of the committee, has asked me to inform you that this is not going to become commonplace in this city. And if you and yours wish to be considered in the future, you will move above Foothill Boulevard or remove yourself from consideration. If you object, we have permission for an annexation to Covina. Also, I realize early in the evening that a number of you and your neighbors are here. We ask you please to keep the key for the curfew and be back below Alasta before 11:30 this evening. Now, for those of you who are now angered at this, let me take a moment to say that while Jim Vincent was mayor in the city of Glendora, Ida and Joe, in their typical, quiet, fashionable way, ordered 12 colored t-shirts that said Baja California and went and sat in the city council and complained about the fact that they were not being represented by our illustrious city council. Now, I don't want to create any hard feelings in here, and I'm not going to name every name, but I would suggest people like Lois Shade, Bob Kuhn, move before next year, or you're not on the docket at all. Now, this evening, we're honoring a couple, and the entire evening will be set up differently than in the past. There will be a number of presenters coming up where you will see Ida and Joel represented by different parties as they come to the microphones. So I would ask that when you are called, if you are coming to the main microphone, you have been told. If you are coming to the minor microphone, you will go to the bottom down here. Minor microphones have 30 seconds and the plug goes, okay? Major microphones can go all the way up to 3 minutes, then I start at your right leg. All right. This is a long evening, my friends. Please do not get carried away. Have a wonderful evening, and I shall return with more in a few moments. Here we go.
Thank you, Ben. Since I've got three presentations, that means I get three times the time?
Three times the time.
No, okay. Last thing I'm going to do is incur the wrath of Ben Bollinger. So it's a great pleasure for me to be here this evening on behalf of Congressman Dreyer and Joe and Ida. I've been working for Congressman Dreyer for about 7 years now, and you were two of the first people I met, I think, when I came to work for him in Glendora. And the Congressman really would like to salute you for the wonderful things you've done for this community during the years. And I have, as Ben said, three presentations, and the first one is from the President of the United States, George Bush. We have an autographed photo signed by the President. It says, "With all best wishes to Joe and Ida Fracasse." And in addition to that, yeah, that's kind of special. In addition to that, we do have a plaque from Congressman Dreyer in recognition of your being named Citizen of the Year for your service to the community, and it's signed by Congressman Dreyer. And last, but certainly not least, I have a personal letter from United States Senator John Seymour, which I will allow you to read and present all of those to you and both Joe and Ida, and congratulations on a great honor.
Thank you very much, Mark. You know, it's really, humility is a wonderful thing. Joe reached over to me, he says, "Ben, did President Bush sign a picture for us? Does he know we're Democrats?" I said, "Hell yes, look at the size of the picture." Remember the one Everett Norv got? Huge suckers, okay? Incredible evening. Yes, but the wonderful thing is this evening we have Assemblyman Richard Mountjoy here, and I must say it's wonderful to have him here in person to make the next two presentations. We'd like to welcome Assemblyman Richard Mountjoy.
Thank you, Ben. I remember when Ben was over at the Presbyterian Church, he ran that congregation out and then moved over to Citrus. Okay. True.
This is your last time talking.
They'll never give me the mic. I have a letter here, and I'd like to read it. "Mrs. Wilson and I are delighted to extend our sincere congratulations to you, and you are recognized by the Glendora Chamber of Commerce as Glendora Citizen of the Year for 1991. California has long been known throughout our nation and its world for its boundless innovation and unrivaled success. The unchallenged ingredient of that achievement, the primary cause and driving force behind the Golden State's history, standing is undoubtedly the spirited citizens who proudly call themselves Californians. These are people who enrich our communities and make our neighborhoods better places for all citizens, every day throughout our towns and cities. Concerned citizens like both of you generously donate their time and energy on behalf of the common good. Through your humanitarian efforts and community resolve, you have earned a place of inclusion amongst these special Californians, and you should take great pride as you are honored for your noble work. Over the years, you have remained steadfast in your endeavors to improve the quality of life for all the people of Glendora, and you should truly feel satisfied that your focus has made a real difference in so many lives. Congratulations once again, and please accept our very best wishes for a joyous celebration and every continued success in the years ahead. Governor Pete Wilson. He's just as long-winded in his speeches as he is in his letters. But the governor wanted me to read that in its entirety for you, and so there you go. I do have a plaque for you from myself. I have noticed, Ben, is it all right if I do a little commercial?
Yes, go right ahead.
Well, I've noticed that you have a whole host of material. I know you're going to have to add on to your room. Still in the construction business, if you call over there at 359-3275, we'll add a room on or whatever you need. But I would like to give you this plaque from the State Assembly, and congratulations for just everything you do for the city of Glendora and its citizens.
Wonderful to see you come by yourself this evening. It must be an election year. Let me get back. Mrs. Mountjoy is here. We're always glad to see her. Mrs. Mountjoy, would you please stand, please? There she is. People always say afterwards, don't you show any respect to anyone? No? All right, now. No, I do my wife. My beautiful wife, Lois, will tell you that I show respect to her continuously, and I'll explain later why. I'd like to introduce to you now our representative, Carol Strayer, for Senator Frank Hill. Carol, please.
I'm delighted that I was invited to come here tonight, and I would like to, on behalf of Senator Hill, say that he is looking forward to representing the city of Glendora after due to the reapportionment. He will be elected probably to this office. We know he will be. And I will be representing Glendora through his office, and I've already met some wonderful people, and I can't get over how wonderful and active this community is. You really have a wonderful, wonderful community, and I'm going to be very happy to represent you. I have a certificate of recognition from the senator, and when I was preparing it for him, he wanted me to really say how delighted he was that there were two people receiving this award, because anyone who's a volunteer knows that if you're married, you can't do something by yourself. It's a team effort. If the wife is doing something, the husband has to support, and if the husband is doing something, the wife has to support. And so we're delighted that you are citizens of the year. From the California State Senate Certificate of Recognition presented to Ida and Joe Fracasse, Citizen of the Year, in honor of your dedication and support of the City of Glendora through community activities benefiting the citizens of Glendora on April 23rd, 1992. Thank you.
Thank you, Carol. Bill Leonard could not be here this evening, and he asked me if I would do the next presentation, because I have done this a number of years. I have it memorized. Let me give it to you, Jonah. Whereas, be it resolved by Senator Bill Leonard that Joe and Ida Fracasse be congratulated on their selection by the Glendora Chamber of Commerce as Citizens of the Year for 1991. Commended on their exemplary record for civic leadership, and extended sincere best wishes for continued success in the future. Bill Leonard, 25th Senatorial District. There they are.
Use the wide angle, please.
Just a little piece of you, man. Just a little piece.
Please.
That always angered me. I remember when I was on the cover of Glendora magazine, I felt they made me look heavy. Now, Next, I would like to introduce Sarah Flores. You know, all my years in the community, I don't know if I've ever... What are you laughing about, Hint? You know what he calls me in this community? An Optifast dropout. I get so tired of drinking that crap. There are 27 people in intensive care that stayed on the program. Oh, I skipped one. Arlo, Sarah, where are you? I'm going to go with you. I'm going to go with you first, Sarah, because I've already introduced you. Sarah's supervisor, Michael Antonovich. Nice to see you, Sarah. Nice to have you with us there. Yeah, let's welcome her, please.
Ida and Joe are very special people because they're part of a family, the family of Glendora. It doesn't matter if it's Baja or Alta. I kind of feel comfortable with Baja. But the County of Los Angeles wants to let you know that its 89 cities and its 10 million people want to tell you, Ida, that your marriage, your friendship, your representation, your caring of this community with your family is what we as Americans like to see. And Glendora is really very privileged to have Joe and Ida. Good health, happiness, and may the prosperity of joy be always yours. God bless you.
Thank you, Sarah. And Arlo, are you here? Arlo, please. Well, Arlo, I'm sorry. I looked down. I know you were here before, dear. Don't get smart or you won't get up here, all right? I looked down and saw Bill Leonard and Bill Lancaster. I always thought they were the same person. Arlo, tell Bill I said that, would you please? I'm dying to get out of teaching.
You may be sooner than you feel. It is indeed a pleasure for me to represent Assemblyman Lancaster tonight as we honor Joe and Ida, dear friends of his and certainly dear friends of mine. I know when we first heard in the office that Joe and Ida had received the Citizens of the Year Award, I thought, oh goodness, how appropriate, because I always think of Joe and Ida together. And then as I went through and thinking of them and the different organizations and activities that they were in, I didn't put them together at all. I put them individually because the various organizations and activities that I knew them from, they were on their own. But that's what makes them so unique, is that they are active and they contribute as individuals, but also as a team. And that truly makes you unique, Joe and Ida, because Glendora and surrounding communities have truly benefited from your love and devotion. The Assemblyman congratulates you, he salutes you, and he wishes you the very, very best. And on behalf of the state of California, he wishes to present you with this resolution from the State Assembly.
Is that my good son?
Could you hold, yeah. On the pictures, could you hold till I get in, please? Thank you. He keeps rushing these pictures. I don't know. There were four or five ever, and I didn't get in yours. I saw them. They just got part of me. It's really interesting. I knew some part this evening being couples that they bring up comments about, you know, cooperation and marriage and all that kind of thing. Joe told me that having separate bathrooms in their house have actually affected their ability to cooperate. capacity. And Ida told me that they sleep in separate rooms. We have dinner apart. We take separate vacations. She says, I'm trying everything I can to keep our marriage together. This is a night that there's really nothing held. Everything you told me is coming out. Don't feel on. Hey, listen, we'll get the rented outfits back before midnight, all right? Next, I'd like to introduce Mayor Pro Tem Marshall Mao. Marshall, are you here? Mao?
Yes, I'm not Mayor Pro Tem, but I'm here.
Well, Molly, I'm sorry. This says Marshall Mao, and if you cannot imitate him, you're not up here, baby. Come right up, darling.
Oh, I'm just too short. That's my problem.
All right.
Well, he just happened to mention that Joe and Ida take separate vacations, but those of you who know Joe and Ida right here in Glendora know that they never take a vacation because they're always here working in the city, and they have a love affair with Glendora. And I'm happy to present to you on behalf of the city this wonderful plaque. You can't buy this in any store. You've seen it. Laser engraved. And it recognizes you as the 1991 Citizens of the Year. And no one deserves greater recognition than the two of you. And we are so pleased as members of the City Council to be able to honor you tonight and thank you for all of your contributions. Thanks so much.
Get in there with her, Molly. Thank you. Wide angle. All right. Thank you very much. Now, Marshall, where are you seated at? If you give Marshall a round of applause also. I have Marshall, yeah. Now, Marshall, yeah, sure, take 30 seconds, and I'll stand right here. You go any longer, you're done, buddy.
Okay.
You've
got the clock running. I would just like to really express my appreciation to Joe and Ida for all that I feel that they have done for me personally, in addition to everything that they've done for the community. But my first introduction really to the community happened about, back in 1983, so that would be 9 years ago, when they happened to do a story on me, and I just really appreciated that, and it just seems like one thing has led to another. When I got involved with the Orange Trees a few years ago, why they just really gave me a great deal of help and assistance in that, and I honestly believe that I wouldn't be here on the City Council today if it hadn't have been for just the number of steps and the support that they have given to me. And I just really appreciate you both very much, and I want you to know that, and I know that this entire community does, and I can't think of a more deserving couple than the two of you to be here tonight, and thank you very much.
There was a lot of talk in the community about you becoming involved with Orange Trees, actually. It's all right, Marshall. You haven't been in that long, you know. Power of vote. Glendora Unified School District President Peggy Harding. Peggy, there, I got that one right. Welcome, Peggy, all right?
Thank you. Joe and Ida, my mother used to say, give people their bouquets while they're still alive and they can smell the flowers. We want you to know that you deserve all the bouquets that you get this evening, both verbally and otherwise. Your contributions to our lives, both personally and as members of the community, are outstanding. Through the Glendoran magazine, you have reminded us to celebrate in so many ways. You remind us to celebrate our past, our history, our colorful characters, and our cherished traditions. You remind us to celebrate our current heroes, our wonderful volunteers of all ages, volunteers who give the gifts of themselves without thought of reward, but you recognize them. You remind us to celebrate our future, our young people, our children, our babies, our hopes and dreams, encouraging them all the budding writers, seeing themselves in print for the first time. You remind us to celebrate what's right with the world. Friends, families and children and schools, community volunteers like you that make Glendora a very special place to live. In celebration of your special place in our hearts, we would like to present you with this plaque, which reads, in recognition of Ida and Joe Fracasse, Citizens of the Year 1991, for encouraging Glendora students through publication of their stories, articles, and pictures, the Glendora Unified School District, Board of Education, Peggy Harding, Mary Lundstrom, Doug Graham, Everett Hughes, Doris Blum, and our superintendent, Patrick Bushman. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Peggy. I told you that would work when I wrote it for you. Next, I'd like the Glendora JCs, represented by Jamie Caldwell. Jamie? There's Jamie back there. Thanks, Jamie.
Patty?
Well, I just wanted to say, obviously, when everybody says thank you, you see enough people up here saying thank you, you might think it gets old, but there were about 150 other people that wanted to come and they wanted to congratulate you, but they're too cheap, so I came anyway. But I am proud to be able to represent the Glendora GCs and say thank you for everything you've done. And when I first met you several years ago when I moved to this community, I knew I was headed in the right direction. So on behalf of the Glendora GCs and myself, I'd like to present this plaque, which recognizes your outstanding leadership in our community and setting such a great example for our young people. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jamie. I appreciate that very much. You know, Jamie brought up a very good point. This event is normally sold out. It's sold out weeks in advance. Odell usually buys two tickets, then two tables, then stands outside and sells tickets for $75 a person. So if any of you got taken, the chamber will reimburse you after this event this evening. What are you laughing at, Ada? You think I'm kidding, right? Next, I'd like to introduce you. Do the servers understand they should be serving dinner during this time? Do they? I don't want you to feel any pressure, people. But hurry. We're running out of awards. I'd like to introduce... Yeah. Oh, it's not done yet. Well, then, we'd like to introduce at this time the Glendora Lions, Dave Mitz. Dave, are you here, please? David, come forward. Well, that's a long ways away. Let me tell you this story. You know, I'd like to... Oh, excuse me. I thought that he was...
God, I'm sorry. I didn't get
sorry, David. He was going to the restroom. I thought that was... I thought that was you.
Yeah, I always like to sit next to Ben. Not that I'm fond of him. He's rather revolting. But I look skinny by comparison, you know. Hi, Dan, Joe. As a representative of the service club, which really began this award some 43 years ago, it's my pleasure to give you a letter for your scrapbook. Now, we figured your house wasn't big enough to give a plaque because of all the others you're going to have, and we didn't want to give Moncho any more business by adding a room. So we're going to give you a letter. But with this letter, we are sending a check to one of your favorite organizations, the Glendora Historical Society. So Ida and Joe have worked with the Lions Club on many of the site projects and also with the Historical Society, so it is really a pleasure to represent the Lions Club and to thank you good people for your years of service to our community.
Thank you. Thank you, Dave. That was a very glib remark, and you will not be on the list of approved speakers next year. Thank you. At this time, I'd like to introduce to you Tom Prevett from the Glendora Rotary. Tom, are you here? There is Thomas. Yeah.
What was that I heard back there? Joe and Ida, it gives me great pleasure. The Rotary Club's motto is service above self, and I can't think of two more deserving people who stand by that ideal and practice it in their everyday lives. The Glendora Rotary Club, in recognition of the exemplary impact you have had on this city and its citizens, awards you this recognition of being co-citizens of the year. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Tom. We appreciate it. Kiwanis will not be represented this year. They could not afford a plaque. Knock it off, Mario. It's there. All right. Now I'd like to introduce to you Diana Robertson, as she represents the Daughters of the American Revolution. Diana, where are you, dear? Oh, there she is.
Yeah.
On behalf of the National Society of the Daughters of the American Revolution, the Serrano chapter, it gives me great pleasure to give this certificate of appreciation to Joe and Ida for their many years of outstanding community service. You both are so deserving of this award, and the DAR just wants you to know how proud we are of you. Congratulations.
God bless you, and God bless America.
I would like to introduce the head table, and I would like to introduce the Fracasse children and their children, the grandchildren, and take just a moment before we move on into some more of the presentations, and then we will have our entertainment. So if we could have it quiet, we can begin. I'd like to introduce first of all the left side guest of honor, Joe and Ida Fracasse, and Chamber Executive Director Pat Haney. Pat? The right side of the table, Beverly Davis, and Chamber President Robert Davis, and the girl who was fortunate enough to catch me at a tender young age, my wife Lois. I'd like to introduce to you now the Fracasse family, and if they would just stand, please. I would like to first introduce Ida's mother, Sylvia Steinberg, here from Liberty, New York, the oldest child, their daughter Lynn Knobs, and her husband Tim, and their daughter Sierra Dawn of Norwalk. Their son Robert and his wife Teresa, and their oldest daughter Allison of Glendora. Their youngest child, son Richard of Upland, and his friend Linda Bolanos of Pasadena. Linda. Ida's brother Len from Liberty, New York, and his wife Bobby, who are celebrating their 20th anniversary, and their youngest son Robert. It's just so wonderful. I know many of us in the room have grandchildren, but I was talking to Joe and Ida's son, Richard, and he was telling me that he used to take long walks with Joe, and I hope you don't mind me saying this, but it's kind of personal, but they would take long walks together, you know, in the evening after dinner, and he would ask Joe, "Daddy, how does the electricity get from post to post?" And Joe would say, "I don't know. I have no idea." He said, "Well, Daddy, what happens like when thunder and lightning happens and the sound and the light and everything?" Joe said, I have no idea. How should I know that?" So they walked for about another 30 minutes and he asked numerous questions. Finally, he looked up at Joe and he said, "Joe, Daddy, I hope you don't mind me asking all these questions." Joe said, "Heavens no, how are you ever going to learn anything?" What are you laughing at, Joe? That's a true story. True story. I'd like to move on at this time now and make just a few presentations before. I don't think people are finished eating, so I'm going to change the entire evening at this point. You don't feel, is that all right? Just keep right on eating, people, and we'll do, I don't want anyone eating while my singers are in the room, so when it gets really quiet, then we'll pay attention to what the real important part of this evening is, all right? I'd like to introduce to you at this time, now, Pat, this is the presentation of the Citizen of the Year plaque by Robert Davis, all right? So, Robert, why don't I bring you forward, and you can do your bit at this time. Robert Davis.
Joe and Ida, it's on behalf of the Glendora Chamber of Commerce, I'd like to present you with the Citizen of the Year plaque. It says, "In recognition of the years of unselfish dedication to the betterment of their community and the welfare of their fellow man." Thank you.
Thank you, Ida. Okay, Ida, we can leave now.
Let me see that, Joe. Well, isn't it amazing how this has improved? Mine has a Polaroid on it, and it's faded.
Thank you.
I'd like to introduce you at this time the gentleman who gave me the instructions for my opening remarks this evening. I called Joe Nava and I said, Joe, are you sure that no one will be offended if I say this? He said, no. In fact, Ben, just to know the support that I want to give you, the limousine will pick you up about 6:30. Lois and I arrived at 7:20, Joe. There was no limousine, you rotten sucker. Thanks a million. Ladies and gentlemen, here's the chairman of our committee, Joe Nava. Joe? And I don't want to ride home either, all right?
You know, you'd think being chairman of this event, I'd get a good seat, but I'm sitting in the back with Bob O'Dell.
Joe, here's the trouble.
That's punishment.
Okay.
First, I'd like to introduce all the other members of our committee. If you're here, please stand up. Their names are listed in the program tonight. Come on, let's stand up. These are all the people that really did the work. I just made sure that the meetings were run and that they were short. That was my job. Joe and Ida, this trophy has 44 great names on it, and I am proud to present this to you on behalf of the Chamber of Commerce. This perpetual trophy will be displayed in the Chamber office. Thank you for all your contributions to the City of Glendora.
Thank you very much, Joe. And at this time, we'd like to ask, if you look on the back of your programs, you'll see a number of men and women listed as Citizens of the Year. And at this time, I'd like to just stop Joe and Ida and let you see the fraternity that you have joined, or sorority. Can you say, how do you do that women's libwise? The group of people you've met in being part of this, all right? But I'd like to ask every Citizen of the Year in the room this evening if you would stand at this time, please. Everyone that has been named Citizen of the Year, would you stand? Please stay standing, please. Joe and Ida, would you stand, please? Joe and Ida. There they are. There's your Citizens of the Year. Thank you very much. And you know, I know that as a young man in 1955, our family moved to Glendora, my brother Don, my three sisters, and I've told you the love affair I have for this city and for all of you. I could never joke and have the fun I have each year with you without you understanding the love we have for this community. And I know that people who couldn't be here this evening, I know one man that I happen to love very much as I was growing up, a man that I respect very much, and he asked me to say congratulations to Joe and I. That's Leonard Ray. Leonard can't be with us this evening, but I know many of you remember him, a great friend, and he wanted to be remembered to you this evening. Now, we would like to, at this time, introduce to you our entertainment for this evening before we go on with other awards. And I think, singers, are you... I don't want the servers to feel any pressure, but please leave the room. We can't get in without you guys. I'm just kidding. So here they are, ladies and gentlemen, the Citrus College Singers. Aren't they pretty? Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, in past years, I would like to just maybe take a few moments to tell you some of the errors that have been made. Sometimes I'm very glib, and my remarks about the young people seem to be glib. I should tell you just a little bit about the young people standing in front of you this evening. The Citrus Singers, as you know, in 1979 became the first American choir ever to win an international choral festival. That was in 79. It's now 1992, and they still remain the only American choir ever to have won an international choral festival. Now, this year, on May the 30th, thank you. This year on May the 30th, the choir that scored second highest number of points in the history of the International Festival was a group from St. Petersburg or from Leningrad, Russia. And for 13 years, they've asked us to come together and to compete with these two choirs. We scored 98.27 points. They scored 97.86. So it was one of the closest competitions in history. And they've asked us to come together. Well, we've always refused. I felt, why go when you're a winner? I don't care what the point spread was. We were in front. What am I going back for, all right? But I have to laugh about it because two magnificent things have happened in the past year. Number one, on the 30th, we will go to St. Petersburg, to Leningrad, to Russia, and we'll take these young people and we'll perform with the Moscow Symphony. We'll travel doing the Lord Nelson, the Vivaldi, and the Mozart Gloria, the Mozart Regina Caeli. We'll be 16, 17 days performing with that same choir that we competed against. And then next year, on the 4th of July, we'll be with the St. Petersburg Choir as we honor the great Scandinavian composers as we go to Norway next year. The Citrus Singers really, I think, have had a fabulous, fabulous run over 23 years. I'm glib and I make smart remarks about what kind of people they are. But I beg you, as I told Pat Bushman before I accepted this evening, we leave tomorrow morning at 7 in the morning for San Francisco, where we're performing at the Marriott Hotel tomorrow night. Saturday night, we're at the Queen Mary. Sunday, San Diego. We move throughout the state. We move throughout the country, representing this community. And I can tell you something. I've been 23 years at Citrus College. I've never had brighter, harder working, classier young people in my entire life than the group you have in front of you tonight. Now, we are here, we're not here every year. We're here, for example, if somebody in here had someone in the Glendora High School, I always say their group should perform or something, but we're here anytime we're asked to be here. And then, of course, the recipients of the award, they get to tell us what they would like to have sung. For example, I have the note from Ida and Joe, what they want to done, but country western is not a big part of our repertoire. I tried like hell to teach Havanagil and it didn't work. So I will now sing it for you. No, I'm just kidding. We're going to sing the selections that Joe and Ida asked us to sing, and the kids are kind of just take over this portion of the program since Everett Hughes embarrassed me terribly last year about saying that he enjoyed their singing but he didn't see them at any point during the performance. I will conduct from this area, and if they screw up, Hughesy, you're on your own. All right, David, here we go. Whenever I call you friend.
There will be no morning star. Tonight. Rhythm, your hands don't notice the rain. bass guitars playing with them. And the company jumps, for he goes gravity. He's the boogie woogie bugle boy company B. He was the boogie woogie bugle boy company B. And when he plays boogie woogie bugle, he's busy at the fiddle's AP. And when he plays, hey, the company jumps, hey, to the bar. He's the boogie woogie bugle boy company B.
Great, but I think a greater experience is being able to witness firsthand some of the great changes that are coming across the world. This next song reflects some of the hope that we have that our world will be better and brighter as a result of what's going on. From a distance, the world looks blue and green, and the snow capped is white. From a distance, the ocean meets the stream, and the eagle takes to flight. From a distance, there is
you look like my friend. You know watching us. God is watching us from our distance.
This next song is dedicated to Joe. I was asked to express myself through song what your wife thinks about you and how much you mean to her. And right now I'm going to sing the song, Wind Beneath My Wings. Must have been cold there in my shadow to never have sunlight on your face. You were content to let me shine that way. You always walked a step behind. I was the one with all the glory, while you were the one with all the strength. Only a face without a name for so long. I never once heard you complain. Did you ever know that you're my hero? And everything I wish I could be, I could fly higher than an eagle. You are the wind beneath my wings. Might have appeared to go unnoticed, but I've got it all here in my heart. I want you to know I know the truth. Of course I know it. I would be nothing without you. Did you ever
exactly Leslie's talking about. Joe asked us to come up here and sing a song for Ida about the way he felt. Right, guys?
Right. Yeah. Yes.
So I think that's what we're going to do. Want to take this?
Okay. You better take it yourself.
This one's back. There we go. Dave?
Da-da-da, da-da-da-da, da-da-da-da. Wah! Crazy about you, baby, want you for myself. Crazy about you, I love you, lost the shell. Give me all your love and all that you can afford. Let me keep you always here that you we adore. Praise God, China. Praise God, China. Praise God, China. Watch all of us now. Praise God, China. Praise God, China.
Now, Tom's come, honey, won't you please come on by? I'll take care of you the rest of your life. I've spent a lot of money, how do you do? Got a jingle door, and you.
Praise
God,
China. Praise God, China. Praise God, China. Want you all to myself.
Praise about China.
Don't know what I'm gonna do.
Praise about China.
I'm bubbling with joy.
Praise about China. Once more to myself. Crazy. Crazy. Praise about China. Once more to myself. After we were married, we will raise a family. All the doubts you had before fit you to a D. We'll be living humble in our own little way.
Fortune, this be the day.
Praise God, China. Praise God, China. Praise God, China. Want you all to myself. Wow. Crazy. I'm so crazy. Crazy, baby. Want you all to myself. Wow.
As you all know, we are going to Europe this year, and to conclude today's concert, I'd like to keep in mind our great country. Because for many, America is the promised land. It promises a hope for a better way of life and freedom and liberty for all. Peoples from around the globe have come together to make this nation one of the greatest melting pots on earth. The pride that each and every American feels while working and living together in their great country shows in the work they do and in their eyes. But nowhere is this pride more evident than in our country's music. The last song we'd like to sing is God Bless the USA. It has inspired many Americans, and I'm sure you'll understand why.
It's tomorrow, all the things we've got and worked for all our lives. And I had to start again, just my children and my wife.
I thank my lucky stars to be living here today. Cause the flag still stands for freedom, and they can't take that away. And I'm proud to be an American, or at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the ones who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today. Cause there ain't no doubt I love this land.
Lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston and New York to LA,
there's a pride in every American heart, and it's time to stand and say.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you so very much for such a wonderful reception for the Citrus Singers. Joe and Ida, I hope their specialty numbers fit you to a T. Wind beneath my wings, Joe, you gotta be kidding. You know what, people, while they're going out, I should tell you, you don't realize this. When these kids came to Citrus, they couldn't sing a note. When I came to Citrus 23 years ago, our district was Claremont to Monrovia. We now have a student from that area in the group. Incredible the way it's worked. We do have a Glendora High School student in our group. And as I go down through, I look at Brad. I have to look to Judy Haynes sitting over here, because Judy is now a detective in our city, and Judy was part of the Citrus Singers at one time. Judy, I won't say anything about it, but if I ever get a ticket, you're dead, okay? Brad, I should say also, Judy, in our friendship, I say to you, you will never, ever have one of those young people up at the jail, I promise you. They don't have time. The only way you're going to get them is recruit them, okay? It's the only shot. I want to just tell you also, just aside before we go on this evening, isn't it interesting the kinds of music that we hear today? The kids bring me music all the time. For example, the other day, one of the girls brought a recording of Madonna. And she says, Mr. Bolger, she sings so well. You won't believe this. I said, I don't like her. She says, she sings so well that when I played her on the stereo the other night, every garage door in the neighborhood opened because she was so in tune. Every garage door opened. Take it home and try it. So I took it to my house. I said, Delois, you're not going to believe this. One of the kids told me every garage door in the neighborhood opened. So I put it on our stereo, turned it up, and every toilet in the house flushed. I don't understand. It must be that my house is used to different music than their house. I think that's what education's all about, isn't it? Education. Young people traveling, and I'll tell you, as we travel through the world, Joe and Ida, I say to both of you what fabulous representatives they are of not only the United States, but our community. When we were with President Bush in Aalborg, Denmark, President Bush gave me a private number. He said, if you're ever in any trouble, call this number. So I called from we were in Poland. He said, George McGovern. You wonder why your picture's small, smart aleck? Now you know. And one final comment, Richard, I would say to you and your lovely wife this evening, all right? You should know that now Glendora is in deep trouble. They have honored Ida and Joe, two Democrats. They have honored me, the third Democrat in town. There are no more Democrats to honor. Oh, yeah? Well, you live below Alastair, so ha ha ha. So I want to see you get out of this one, Nava. Sure. Well, now I'm going to settle down that I'm not angry anymore. Is Ida still in the ladies' room?
Pardon me, yes, she is.
Is she, Molly? I don't have a lot of more material, you know, and I can't, if she's got to go, I'm leaving.
She's washing her hands.
You're washing your hands, all right. Well, at that, then I'm going to just go on with the evening, if you don't mind. And Joe, you know, it's very nice. I think you should have it anyway. We're going to move. I can't go to the next section, Joe. It's IDOS. Isn't it named after her? Said, Ida will be in the restroom for 23 minutes. Pat, can you do something about this, please? Let me go back to that Havana Gila. I worked on it all week. Did she really just... Is this a ploy on her part just to walk out on the event?
She's having a great conversation.
Okay, well, then I'm just going to move to... Is she coming? Don't put any pressure on her. Yeah, just tell her. Tell her I'll give her the Madonna recording. Culver, could you get me off the hook here? Where are you, Culver? Culver, I'm going to skip the IDOS bit here tonight and move on, because we're just moving very well. We'd like to move here to the Glendora Historical Society and Kiwanis Club. Culver Heaton, our deputy city manager, if you would come. And then, of course, Linda Price, the Historical Society, and Doug Logan, the Kiwanis president. Could I ask, please, Linda and Doug also, if you'd be prepared to just come up front here. Ida, you might as well leave. It's over, baby. All right?
This is a benediction, isn't it?
Ladies and gentlemen, as you will soon hear from other presenters this evening, Joe and Ida's community service in Glendora dates back to the 1960s, when our former Avon lady, Ida, organized the Glendora chapter of Beta Sigma Phi. My task this evening is to share with you the inside scoop on their contributions to the Glendora Historical Society and the Glendora Kiwanis Club. Prior to Ida's becoming president, the Historical Society had enjoyed a somewhat ho-hum existence in Glendora since it was first organized in 1949. In 1987, when she became president, the Society's activities and visibility in the community simply exploded in a dozen areas of activity. As Ida puts it, no one else would accept a presidency that year. She had already served as the Board of Directors secretary, and it was difficult to say no to the board on this new challenge. At that point, the Society was very close to going out of existence if someone didn't step forward and take the challenge as president. Well, when Ida became president, she decided that her number one goal would be to remodel and expand the museum building. She started off by getting the bylaws revised, raised membership dues, revitalized, and established new committees. However, she really had her hands full, because then she also needed to find a new museum curator to take charge of the museum's collection and prepare it for display when the remodeling was completed. Finally, after searching for a curator, she saw the shining light at the end of the tunnel in the form of two new curators who eagerly stepped forward to take the assignment as a husband and wife team. Alas, as time would prove, the shining light at the end of the tunnel would turn out to be none other than the headlights of an onrushing locomotive, which nearly caused her demise over the next several years. As one longtime member put it, until Ida came along, we were just plodding along. Her enthusiasm perked us all up and we got energized and really got moving with some new activities and a new major fundraising effort. A docents committee was formed and the museum was open to the public every Sunday, not just once a month. Arrangements were made so that more school children could visit the museum and learn about Glendora's marvelous history during the school week. She worked with Glendora architect Norm Nichols and then Mayor Ken Prestesater to come up with a concept plan for the new museum remodeling. Before long, she and her husband Joe were appearing before the Glendora City Council reporting that the Society could pledge $70,000 as their share of the total $100,000 remodeling project. Joe and Ida organized fundraisers, pledge drives, and solicitations to the residents and business in the community to make the new addition possible. When the receipts were all counted, the Society had raised $69,300 as their share of the expansion project. After 2 years of furious effort to expand the museum, it was opened to the public at a gala ceremony on a stormy evening in June 1989. The new wing of the building was dedicated as the Merrill West Wing as a memorial and in recognition to Merrill's foresight a few years earlier that this was a needed project in the community. Today, the Society's membership has grown to over 200, and I think in great respect, Ida's efforts is the contributor to that fact. Although Ida was the Historical Society president for three terms of office between 1987 and 1992, husband Joe was her perpetual sidekick, providing support and doing tough jobs and working on publicity. His 30 years of experience in the insurance industry were put to good use. Have you ever noticed that they're really an amazing pair? They're always together. Joe in support of Ida's projects and Ida with Joe in support of his projects. I know for a fact that they are inseparable on Saturday and Sunday mornings. For instance, Saturday morning, they visit all the yard sales in Glendora. And on Sunday, they religiously attend the swap meet at the Azusa Drive-In Theater. Now, on more than one occasion, the museum curators, Linda Price and Kay Hall, have questioned the authenticity of new historic items that Joe and Ida find for the display in the museum. And they question if these items were not from Glendora, but really from Azusa families. Well, let's focus for a moment on Joe's involvement in the Kiwanis Club for a minute. Other than being Glendora's oldest service club, what does the name Kiwanis really mean?
The name Qantas has an Indian origin. It is a coin word from the language of the Indians around Detroit, where the club was formed in 1915. Literally translated, Qantas means makes big noise, has big fun. And that is exactly what Joe does in Qantas. Makes big noise, has big fun. He was sponsored into our club membership by old Mayor Joe Finkbeiner. So that shows you just how long he's been around, right? Well, Joe has served the club as a member of the board of directors. He's been the club bulletin editor, club photographer and video recorder, an expert pancake flipper at all of the annual pancake breakfast fundraisers, and a host of other activities that he's always counted upon to help. True to his Qantas colors, Joe is a bit of a prankster, though. And when he was the Qantas bulletin editor, one time he's conspired with Rotary Club bulletin editor Ted Myers to superimpose the Qantas insignia over the Rotary insignia on the cover of the Rotary Bulletin. The news in the bulletin was likewise debauched, with items such as announcing that Rotary Gordy Norman and Qantas member Ben Bollinger were going into partnership with Jack Hall. And they were going to train the kids at the Casa Carmen Mentally Handicapped Home to go on tour in Europe with Ben as the Casa Carmen singers. Now, according to Joe, none of the Rotarians ever reacted to this trick, and he thought they were just too old to stay up late at night and read their bulletins. Well, you know, in closing, I'd like to share with you something that Joe and Ida's friends in the Historical Society and the Qantas Club have to say about them. They have high energy and are serious in what they do. They are dedicated people. They don't make you worry. When they say it will be done, it gets done. They are persistent and dependable. Ida doesn't know the meaning of the word no. There is nothing that she doesn't do well. She is a great cook, homemaker, and mother. They are devoted to their family. They work as a team. They support each other's interests. Joe will do almost anything. Ida runs a great meeting, keeps the business flowing. She is open to suggestions and is flexible. Darling Joe, without him, Ida couldn't have done it all. He is always there to help her. Well, I know one thing for sure. Joe and Ida love to study history. And they particularly love to study the history of Glendora. Thanks to each of you for giving so much of yourselves to the Glendora Historical Society and the Glendora Qantas Club. And at this time, I would like to introduce Linda Price, the co-curator of the museum, as well as Doug Logan, the president of the Glendora Qantas Club, and make presentations. Thank you.
Well, I have to make sure all the pictures are taken. Joe and Ida, on behalf of the board of directors of the Glendora Historical Society and the over 200 members, we want to present this plaque to you as a representation of our love for you. It says, Glendora Historical Society honors Joe and Ida Fracasse, 1991 Glendora Citizens of the Year. Congratulations. We're all so very proud of you, and we love you.
Glendora Kiwanis Club is proud to honor one of its own. Glendora Kiwanis Club is also proud to have been one of the organizations that put into nomination Joe and Ida tonight. And we'd like to present this plaque from Glendora. Kiwanis Club of Glendora honors Joe and Ida Fracasse for being selected Glendora 1991 Citizens of the Year. Thank you for your contribution to the spirit of Glendora and for making a difference in the community for many years. Congratulations.
Earthquake.
Not wide enough.
Hey, Culver, while they're going back to their seats, could you, I wrote down a question. When you go back in the city, could you ask, why does a slight tax increase cost $200 and a substantial tax savings 30 cents on a return? Could you, just a couple. Yeah, I have some questions for Brad later on too, but could you write that one down? Thank you very much. And Culver, that was the longest 3 minutes in the history of mankind. Thank you. Joe, stay out of it, okay? I know Joe, but tell Pat also, stay out of it. IDOS. I would like to now go to IDOS. See, now, Ida, am I right? This was actually named after you. And you were in the restroom when I tried to do this, so if you could now, you know, pay attention, because this is one of the real big ones, okay? This is IDOS, and I'd like to introduce Isabel Stokes. And Isabel, if you'd come forward at this time. Isabel? Okay, and Myrna Spears, IDOS president. Isabel, you can come up here. Come right to the front, Michael. Thank you very much.
I'm glad you gave me that extra time. The tears were flowing as they were singing.
Thank
it was
you
beautiful. 17 years ago, Ida's mother, Sylvia Steinberg, who lives in New York, was the inspiration of the start of the Ida's Club. She suggested that Ida start a social and support group for the visually impaired, like she went to back in New York. The club is named for Ida, and it is pronounced Ida. Just like the letters state that eye diseases are serious. Sylvia Steinberg has retinitis pigmentosa, or RP, which has taken her sight. Ida became very aware of the fact that RP is a high-risk disease for her children, so she started research on the subject. And she started, along with her sorority sisters, from the Delta Alpha Tau of Beta Sigma Pi, to put the RP on its International Endowment Fund. And as a result, thousands of dollars went into the new RP Foundation. Through this club, she has fought for audio signal lights and handicap parking for the blind. Prior to a letter-writing campaign, only blind veterans were allowed to use the handicapped parking along with other disabled. She also speaks for programs on the IDAs to promote membership, make organizations aware of their services, and make an appeal for drivers to get members to and from our meetings. Joe represents the Glendora Kiwanis and helps in the service, going to pick up wherever he is needed in the San Gabriel Valley. Ida looked into some restaurants which did not admit guide dogs, and were she told them that this was illegal, and that guide dogs were always allowed with their mistresses and masters. Ida, we salute you. You are a very dedicated lady, and we love you for all you've done for the visually impaired. Joe has been right beside Ida all the way, driving and listening, and now recording many of our meetings by video. These two people are a tremendous asset to their community and are a team when it comes to humanitarian efforts to those less fortunate, especially the visually impaired. Congratulations, Joe and Ida, from all of the Ida Club members.
Get a picture here.
Okay, now you're good.
Good evening. I'm Myrna. I don't hear myself. Here I am. I'm Myrna Spears, president of the IDAS Club. And 4 years ago when we moved to Glendora, we were very surprised to find such a club that would concern itself so faithfully with the problems of the visually impaired. And I can tell you that Ida and Joe worked together so well for the interests of us all and for the good of the community, and especially for those of us who have visual problems. And anyone wearing glasses, from that point on, you're a member of the IDIS Club, and we expect to see you every second Monday of the month. Now, Ida and Joe, I want you to know that we all hold you in great esteem and affection, and we'd like to present this to you. It's not in Braille, and I don't know what it says, so...
Says to the citizens of the year, outstanding service and support, the Irish Club. Oh, it's beautiful. And we have our names on it.
That's great.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Not to be humorous about this, I'd take just a moment to tell you that Citrus, I play football with a young man by the name of Jim Redmond, and Jim's son is now in my class, David. And David came to class, and he is unsighted. He has lost his sight. He's one of the finest young men I've ever had. He's in my voice class at Citrus College, and he has a big black Labrador that sits next to him during the entire class. So we had midterm examinations the other day. David got a C, and the dog got a B+. David's not singing well, but the dog's upper register is improving. At this time, I would like to introduce to you our Library Board Cablevision, Connie Tiffany, Director of the Glendora Library, and Frank Sherborne, Friends of the Library. So Connie and Frank, if you come forward, we'd appreciate it very much.
Get organized here, that's always the first order of business for a librarian, right? Since this seems to be kind of a no-holds-barred, let's-don't-hold-anything-back kind of night, it's time I told you all that I'm the fourth Democrat in Glendora.
Do you live above Alaska?
I think I do. Barely. Just about enough. Also, I was waiting for Culver to tell this story about the history of Kiwanis that I heard from Joe when I first came to town. I can't tell it because I don't know all the details, but it had something to do with Joe at one time proposing Ida to be the first woman member of Kiwanis, and that not being terribly well received. Times have changed. Of course, I got into Rotary before Kiwanis admitted any women. Okay, I'd like to start by honoring Joe for his contribution to the Cable Television Committee. I first got to know Joe as the husband of Ida, and we'll talk about why that is in a minute. Great, I get a train. But then I soon got to know Joe in his own right, and I was very privileged to get to work with him on the Cable Television Committee, where he patiently dedicated 3 years to helping us develop some very meticulous rules and regulations, as we call this creative document, that's a way that allows all of you to have an opportunity to produce a program to get on our local cable television channel 29 and speak for your organization and show the community what your organization does. And we're very proud of his efforts and the efforts of all of that committee in bringing this about. Joe also was very pleased to contribute his services behind the camera, taping such events as Miss Glendora over and over and over again. And And he was a real wheeler dealer for us, helping us establish some additional equipment access facilities at the library. He researched very carefully the best price for us and drove all over the Los Angeles area and picked equipment up and took it in for repair and just really helped us get that program off the ground. In fact, last year we were pleased to recognize his contributions by giving him his very own director's chair, which I'm sorry he's not sitting in tonight, because that would have been a real glamorous touch. So I'd like to start by presenting one of Joe's prized contributions to our efforts. Congratulations. And in addition. Most of his productions were really much more successful than that. Ida Fracasse has a very special place in my heart. She not only served the longest of any other commissioner in the city of Glendora, serving her 20 years on the library board. During that time, she was president 3 times. She helped physically move the building from its old quarters, which are now the council chambers, to its new quarters in 1972. She saw it grow from a collection of 48,000 books to 95,000 books. She saw the budget grow from $180,000 to $1.3 million just before she retired from the library board last year. But of course, I think the most important accomplishment of Ida's term on the library board was she helped hire me. For that, I'm tremendously grateful. And that's one of the reasons that she asked me to speak tonight instead of my current board president, Jim Nakano, who would have said that that was the worst mistake that she ever made. But I'm really very pleased to have been able to participate in this ceremony and to honor Ida. And this is for you, very special, from the library board and the library and the whole community. Thank you.
It's my pleasure to speak on behalf of the Friends of the Glendora Library, and especially to acknowledge that Ida and Joe Fracasse have been friends of the Friends at several points in the history of our organization. During my tenure as co-president of the Friends, they have befriended the Friends by taping the This I Remember book celebration when we celebrated the publication of the book written by Helen Bateen. Many of you have probably seen that tape on Channel 29. And it has stimulated a lot of interest in the Friends, and I know that's part of the reason for our remarkable growth during this past year. But the Fracasses were friends of the Friends long before I came on the scene. I don't need to tell those of you who are assembled here tonight that most service clubs tend to ebb and flow over time. The tide has not always been flowing like it is now for the Friends of the Library. And some of the older members of the Friends tell me that it was during one of the ebb tides in the history of the Friends that Joe and Ida befriended us. As president of the library board one of those times, Ida spoke to the Friends to encourage them in their work, and as publishers of the Glendoran, the Fracasses published an article about the work of the Friends that stimulated a lot of interest in our organization. And over the years, in many similar ways, large and small, I and Joe have supported the work of the Friends. And so in honor of your selection as Citizens of the Year, and as a token of our appreciation for your faithful support, and as a gesture of affection between friends, I would like to present you with this engraved plate. Congratulations.
Frank, can I ask you, did someone offer you $25 for every time you used the word friend? Because if I'm a friend of the Fracasses, I'm a friend of the Friends of the Friends of the Fracasses, right? That's incredible.
This next person is difficult for me to introduce. It really is. You know how with certain people, like when you introduce a priest, a kind of a someone who's helped you, things well up with inside you? That's not the feeling that I get at all when I introduce Don Hitt. I'd like to take just 1 second before Don comes up and say that this Optifast thing we were joking about, I lost 85 pounds before I went to Europe last time. I gained 113 on the trip. Why don't you come on up, Don? Frankly, I don't give a damn what you say.
Just be nice. He really and truly was a Optifast dropout. You know, he spoke of when his picture appeared on the cover of the Glendora. When my picture appeared, I was a little disappointed, and I went to Ida and I said, I'm disappointed that you didn't ask me to pose for a centerfold. And she says, well, Don, if I had asked you to pose for a centerfold, I would have had to have asked Ben. I said, we do have to sell this magazine.
Let's get right on with it.
I will have to confess that I don't really recall exactly the first time that I met Ida and Joe. When I first came to Foothill, many of you were here at the time, and I came from the big city of Hemet, and it just seems that I came from that place out there in retirement land and landed in the fast lane on the Model T Ford. There were so many meetings and community functions that everything really became a blur. But within that blur, the faces of Ida and Joe Fracasse appeared over and over again. It seems to me that these two people spend their lives attending meetings and community functions. Some people are addicted to golf, some become couch potatoes during football and basketball season, but these two people are truly addicted to community activities. In 1984, I was approached by Penny Gongwer, who's here this evening. Penny at that time was the executive vice president of Foothill Presbyterian Hospital. Penny told me that Ida had approached her about establishing a low vision center at FPH. Penny had located a potential site across from City Hall, which had recently been vacated by the YWCA, the old Underhill home. Many of you know where that is, owned by Bob O'Dell. Coming from an accounting background, it was not hard to figure out that this would probably not be a venture that would really pay off money-wise. However, Ida set her mind to having a low vision center here in Glendora, and she was determined to make it happen. Is anyone here aware of how pushy this lady can be? I think it's fair to say that she had no intention of letting this opportunity slip by. Ida quickly countered the concern over money by saying that she knew of funds that were available in many nooks and crannies of Glendora, and with her help, she could get some of those funds and help overcome that deficit that I certainly anticipated. As you are aware, the center became a reality and is still functioning as a part of our education center in the same location today. Although it constantly requires some financial subsidy from the hospital, it has answered a definite need for many who have been declared legally blind. Speaking of legally blind, I printed this in small type, that's all I can do to keep from doing this. I think it's difficult for us to measure the value of some of the things that we do in life in terms of dollars and cents. I'm sure there are many who have come to the center with only a blur of vision and left with some hope of being able to read and sew again, or just be able to safely cross the street, who would attest to that. This plaque is to recognize Joe and Ida for their vision, for their ability to make things happen to help this community be a better place for us to live. I'd like to do something that I did last year at this time. I'd like to have everyone who is or ever has been a Foothill employee, a member of our board, or the board of an affiliated corporation, a member of our medical staff, an FPH volunteer or auxiliary, a member of our foundation board, a member of our men's club, or assisted us with our community functions as a volunteer, to please stand, if you would. Could you stand at this time? If you meet any of that category.
What if you were in intensive care?
Okay.
Could you remain standing just a moment?
Just remain standing just a moment, because you're going to help me present this. Joe and I, it's from all of these people who I lovingly refer to as the Foothill family that I present you this plaque, which reads, presented to Joe and Ida Fracasse, 1991 Glendora Citizens of the Year, for many years of community service and your support of Foothill Presbyterian Hospital's programs, including the Foothill Center for the Partially Sighted, from the administration, board of directors, medical staff, and employees of the Foothill Presbyterian Hospital and affiliates, and all of these people. Thank you very much.
We'd like to go right on. Thank you so much, Mr. Hitt. How about if you were intensive care once? Does that count? I almost did, but I was so embarrassed. Crime Stoppers and the Coordinating Council, Sharon Meyer, Director of Crime Stoppers, and Joyce Hughes, Coordinating Council President. Joyce, if you and Sharon would come forward at this time, please. Would you come up here, honey? Joyce, you take it.
I'd like to begin by calling my friendship with Ida and Joe a close encounter of a very special kind, a community service kind, and here's why. My story is really in two parts because there's two people. Let me tell you, first of all, how I came to know Joe. You see, my husband and I were attending a reception in late 1987. For a new hospital administrator here in town. And we happened to stop to talk to Joe and Ida. And you guessed it, Joe is in a selling mood. Isn't Joe in a selling mood a lot of times? Well, of course. He said the word Crime Stoppers. And well, being sort of a Dick Tracy fan, I made the fatal mistake of saying, what is Crime Stoppers? He had his pitch all prepared, and I was so intrigued, never having worked with crime and law enforcement before. He said, I'm looking for a few good people to start a Crime Stopper program here in Glendora. He also said, Crime Stoppers is a community-based crime prevention program that unites the public, the media, and the police in the fight against crime in our community. The benefits sounded terrific. Crimes were solved, stolen property was recovered, narcotics confiscated, and criminals were put behind bars. Did that sell me or what? Joe, the salesman that he is, convinced me to join the team. The founding board met for the first time shortly thereafter. And in retrospect, Joe, working quietly behind the scenes, was like an artist molding this new organization and putting it together into a working body that would become a real deterrent to crime in Glendora. That was in 1989. He has continued to serve on the board of directors and lend his special expertise in public relations, producing a video for cable designing posters with Agent Kathy Harbour of the Glendora Police Department, designing crime line business cards, and serving on numerous committees. Most of all, though, Joe lends a caring concern for others. In committing his time, such a very precious commodity indeed, in this way because he cares. He is blessed with an infectious enthusiasm that drives a lot of people crazy, I know. But what more could anybody ask for in serving with Joe on any board? Joe, on behalf of the Glendora Crime Stoppers and our board of directors, I would like to present you with a certificate of appreciation for all the hours of hard work you, the artist, have devoted to the program. Your enthusiasm and support are truly, truly appreciated.
Okay.
I'm certainly not going to leave Ida out of this, am I? No way. My association with Ida began back in 1982. She was president of the Glendora Community Coordinating Council, and I had just been invited to join the board of directors. The purpose of this council, for your information, is to bring together community organizations in cooperation to meet the needs of its people. Oh boy, I mean, this was where Ida's personal goals shone like a bright star. She was president of the Glendora Community Coordinating Council from 1981 to 1983, picking the theme, Together We Share and Together We Serve. Serve, and that's Ida. You know it from the start. During her term, a record 150 holiday baskets were distributed, and the campership goal was far exceeded during her presidency. 1986, Ida was awarded the Jean Beckwith Humanitarian Award by the Council. This was for the outstanding and innovative leadership she displayed during her presidency. It was Ida's idea to establish the Community Service Award System. Oops.
All right here, baby.
Okay. There's a little hold out here that I didn't know about. Whoa. Okay. You're right, just disappeared. That's what I felt like. Okay. 1986. Let's get back to 1986. Ida was awarded the Jean Beckwith Humanitarian Service Award by the Council. This was for Ida's innovative and special outstanding leadership that she displayed during her presidency. It was Ida's idea to establish the Community Service Award System that the Council still uses and has expanded to encompass youth as well. She perceived this award should honor individuals and groups for their contributions in the field of community service. Now, does that sound like Ida or what? Maybe it was that personal dedication to community service that drew me into a special friendship with both of our recipients. You see, there is nothing I believe in more myself. Well, back to history. 1987, after leaving the presidency, Ida was awarded the Los Angeles County Federation of Community Coordinating Councils Community Service Award. You know, I was looking through the minutes that when she was president, and I found in the historian's book the following writing. This writing was found in the minutes of the first year of Ida's presidency and exemplifies her thinking, I think, to a T. Council. C. The first letter of council stands for community. We all know Ida loves her community. O. The second letter stands for outstanding and Ida's outstanding in involvement. U stands for unity. Without unity, Ida knew goals couldn't be completed and attained. N, the fourth letter, stands for needs. Needs which are fulfilled by joint effort. Ida understands needs and what joint effort can accomplish. C, the second C in council stands for cooperation in making an effective and viable organization. Ida is effective because she understands cooperation and the truth that many hands make lighten on the load. I, the sixth letter, involves you and I and all of the aspects of organizational life in Glendora. Involved, oh yes, Ida is very, very involved. L, the last letter of council, stands for love. Love that has been shared, helping love, the same love that is evident when we all work together to make Glendora a better place to live. Yes, I think Ida measures up beautifully, don't you? And now I know why, and now I want you, and I hope you understand why, I call my friendship with Ida and Joe a close encounter of a very, very special kind. And my congratulations to you both. And I believe Glendora's Community Coordinating Council's current president, Joyce Hughes, has a presentation at this time.
Ida and Joe, on behalf of the Coordinating Council, it's my pleasure to present you with this scrapbook for all the extra stuff that I know that you already have, with our love and sincere best wishes and congratulations.
It was a little long, Joyce. Next, I would like to, you know, as I sit here this evening and look from the head table out, I see Brad Posey, I see Pat Bushman. You know, what a blessing for me. I don't know how other people feel. I certainly think I know how you feel. What a great community. I really mean this sincerely. It's hard for me to be sincere. But Brad, our friendship, the students that have come to you through our program at Citrus College, the community, and, you know, it's interesting, and I've never been a great fan of, call, you know, of any administrators. All of you know that. When I came from Ramona High School, it said Ben Bollinger is an outstanding musician, an excellent leader, so on and so forth. He has no use for administrators or administrative discipline. And Bob Hall hired me anyway because I was the only USC applicant, and that's all he ever hired anyway. All right? But I had to get a big kick out of this next guy because Pat said to me one time when my kids were growing up, and I don't know if you remember this, Pat, he said backstage at a Rotary Fest, he says, Ben, how come your kids go to Damien High School? I said, well, Pat, we were raised Catholic, Don and I, we went to Catholic schools all the way through until we came down here, and I went to Citrus High School. We've been to Catholic schools all year, so my wife wanted the kids to be raised Catholic, and why the hell are you asking me? Well, you went to Lyle High School, what are you questioning me for? I mean, he went all the way through. We haven't spoken until tonight, and I would like to say to Pat, that's not true. Patrick, it's a thrill to be around you. What great leadership you've given our schools. And the Glendora magazine is, to me, a great joy, a thrill for this community. I don't know another community that's blessed to have a publication like this. And we've asked our superintendent of the Glendora Unified Schools, Dr. Pat Bushman, to honor our honorees this evening. Patrick.
Thanks, Ben. Guy went to Damien, huh? I mean, you're sending kids to
all
Damien.
All three of my sons. They wanted to see all three of them.
We call that Loyola High School, not Loyola.
Well, they were always Loyola.
There's a few out there that know that, right, Tim? Well, ladies and gentlemen, it's a pleasure for me to acknowledge Joe and Ida for what we would all agree is certainly one of their most significant and lasting contributions to this community. It's been mentioned many times before this evening, the Glendoran magazine. Perhaps you weren't aware of it before the magazine came into publication, but Joe had for a long time harbored the ambition to be a publisher-writer. even while developing a successful insurance business. And Ida, of course, had previously written the Liberty Bell column in the Glendora Press, as well as putting together The View for the Chamber of Commerce in the late 1970s and the early 1980s. But now, it can be finally told how the inspiration for this magazine really began. It seems that late one night, about 10 years ago, you remember this, Joe, right? Joe was startled awake. Now, we all know Joe, and we can probably get an idea of what might have awakened him at 2:30 in the morning. Much to Ida's surprise, however, and perhaps even disappointment, Joe nudged her awake to talk. And talk they did for the next several hours, and in fact, the next 4 hours, almost nonstop, about his brainstorm idea for a new periodic magazine featuring Glendora. The conversation even continued over breakfast at our local Caro's restaurant, and thus the Glendora began. Joe designed the logo. Ida was an inveterate writer. Joe loved photography. Ida loved stories about people. And then Joe decided he'd make up a cover, a make-believe cover, and put 48 pieces of paper in it to simulate what the magazine might look like. And then figured out, Joe did, along with Ida, how many ads would they need to sell to break even. And the first bi-monthly magazine came out in January 1983. Here's a copy. This is it, the original magazine in 1983. And they remember this well. This is the current magazine to show you how far it's come. Thought you'd be interested to see those too, Joe. I know you guys have those in your archives. Many questioned when they did this project in 1983 about the magazine's longevity. They asked Joe and Ida, after you write about the Rubel Castle and Ruth Richardson, then what are you going to write about? Now, 9.5 years later, they still have touched but a minuscule amount of Glendora's rich history and the fascinating story of its people. Writing stories about Glendora has always been pleasurable for this business couple, but sometimes the process can be difficult when you're searching out for stories. A special issue on senior citizens and their service was a very difficult job for Joe because no one would admit that they were a senior citizen. Except Larry Glenn, who first admitted he was a senior after he learned there were numerous discounts available for seniors. And to point out how writing can be very perilous, Joe recalls that on their first anniversary issue, the centerfold was scheduled to be an aerial view of the Rubel Castle. Joe was to take the photo, and the pilot was Chris Rubel. Some of you know about that. They flew from Cable Airport between fog banks because it was completely overcast and fogged in that day, and ensuring to make their deadline that they would get this historic shot. Joe was left hanging out with a strap to take these pictures out of a vintage World War I plane to get this classic set of pictures. And he swore from then on he'd leave all future aerial shots to someone else. There have been many, many rewards in doing the magazine that Joe and Ida have shared with me. Essentially, the production, ladies and gentlemen, is hardly more than a break-even enterprise. But listen to their attaboy anecdote as told by Joe. This is Joe talking. We were at a chamber mixer. This little lady with white hair grabbed me by the jacket and said, "You're doing such a fantastic job with that magazine. I love it. I can't wait to read it from cover to cover." She then, as Joe said, walked across the room, and in a loud voice when she got on the other side of the room, said, so that everybody could hear, "And do you know why? Because when I finish it, I feel good." As Joe states, we focus on people who don't get recognition. Ordinary people. That's our philosophy. That's why the magazine is so successful. And did you know that the magazine is one of the most stolen items in Glendora? Brad, you know this. From doctors and dentists' office, lawyers, CPAs, so much so that many doctors and dentists have doubled their subscriptions.
They don't know. Well, I'm in there stealing it, dude.
Kind of cheapened the whole message, didn't it? Come on, Joe. You might wonder how this terrific couple could work so closely together and make, you know, this project turn out so well. They've got a real routine here. As Ida states, in the beginning and even today, we can't agree. So we decided one month he would be boss, and one month I would be boss. However, as Ida complains, he always forgets when it's my month to be boss. We all know Joe's a very technical type guy. The magazine has been modernized, as I showed you here, in the past decade, from a simple typewriter copy to computer design layouts, laser printing, laser technology. And Ida has been reminded on more than one occasion by Joe, who is this technical type of guy, about these new processes. After working 4 straight hours typing the Betty and Lowell Andrews story, Ida hadn't saved the document on her computer, and the computer bombed. Later, much later, Joe came home, and here was Ida in a catatonic state, staring at that blank screen. With all of the warnings that Joe had given her about the importance of saving her work, it didn't have a fraction of the impact as that moment of truth. What an object lesson. I'd like to take this moment on behalf of our school board, the school district, to pay special tribute to Joe and Ida for featuring Glendora school-aged children in the annual fall editions each September, and they've done that for the past 4 years. These features have meant a great deal to Glendora students, our staff, parents, and our extended community, as Board President Peggy Harding stated earlier. Ladies and gentlemen, a seminal historical look at Glendora was completed by Don Pfluger in 1951, appropriately entitled Glendora. Pfluger's work has served as a historical reference for all of us to better understand Glendora, its history, its people since the middle 1800s. Since 1983, Ida and Joe have published a continuing update of Glendora in what must be regarded as a very unique publication for any city in this country, but certainly understandable and doable in this particularly highly unique community. The Glendoran magazine continues to bring us further understanding of Glendora's history, its people and events, both on a current basis, as well as tracing our historical antecedents, while adding so much history to the original volume by Don Pfluger. And I know you remember the marvelous tribute that Ida and Joe published, I might hold up here, on the anniversary of Glendora's centennial in 1987, titled The First 100 Years. The publication was completed in an unheard of 5 months. Beautiful work. You know, the mortality rate for magazines is tremendous. 2 years is commendable. 3 years is like, wow. Joe recently stated, we're concluding 10 years, and that'll be coming up very soon. Ladies and gentlemen, one criteria on the Citizen of the Year application is, and I quote, has left a lasting legacy on the community. By any standard, this couple has certainly made a magnificent contribution to Glendora. Joe and Ida, we salute you. Thank you.
Now I would like to ask the Kwanians and the Bloomers Garden Club, that would be Molly McLeod, Dorothy Rainey, Georgia Lee Hawthorne of the Bloomers Garden Club.
All
I'm a late bloomer. I'd like to know how you named it yourself. I was going to ask you. No, I won't ask you that, Molly. I was going to ask you how to get into the bloomer stuff.
I'm not going to say that. Oh. Ida asked me to keep this brief. It's the end of the evening, and she said she's soon going to have to make a trip to the women's restroom. But anyway, tonight I want to talk briefly on behalf of Kwanians and Bloomers, but more specifically, Joe and Ida had asked me to talk to you a little bit about some personal information you may not be aware of. So let me briefly share some remarks with you, and then we'll look forward to hearing from our guests of honor tonight. As some of you may be aware, Ida not only goes to these swap meets and garage sales and so forth, but on the weekends, Ida is a woman who loves being out in her yard. Now, you look at this woman tonight, you see this elegant woman. It's a fashion statement and it's a good one. I mean, you look wonderful tonight. But if you saw her on a Saturday morning, filthy, grubby jeans, climbing in her olive tree and pruning it into some decorative feature that is seen right outside the dining room window. And that, you may not be aware of this because I wasn't until I went over to the house and interviewed Ida at her house. This brings her the greatest joy. She said she looks forward to getting up in the morning, doing all of the cleaning and the housework so that she can get out into that yard, trim that tree, pick a few flowers, and bring them back into her house. And this love of gardening and of the earth and seeing things grow and blossom is something that inspired Ida to create this informal Bloomers Garden Club here in Glendora. And it's something maybe you're not even aware that it exists, but there are a number of women who meet, and they share ideas, they give each other clippings and plants, and just share a little bit of life as it grows from the earth. And it's a real special joy of Ida's, and you may not be aware of that. So she began the Bloomers Club about 17 years ago, and it's still in existence today. And in a moment, I think you'll hear from Georgia Hawthorne on that. Now, you also know that Ida's been very active in Kwanians, which is a club that's very close to my heart. And she has participated in so many of our events, and she's always been there to support, always been there to do whatever the club needed. And despite her hectic schedule, she's been a very, very valued member. And in addition, she has also been a seminar speaker at our Kwanian conference for two different occasions. And I would just mention as an aside, she's done the same kinds of involvements with the Glendora Women's Club, and that hasn't been mentioned, but that should be mentioned tonight. Let me turn my attention for a second to Joe. As you know, Joe is a wonderful photographer, and he has done such a fabulous job documenting local history with photographs and videos, and he remembers this big Highway 39 cleanup. Now, I didn't hear the whole story on this, but apparently you were out there picking up everything under the sun, and it wasn't pleasant. It wasn't a pleasant experience, but this guy goes out there and he works his tail off. Also, you might be interested to know that both Joe and Ida were the only Glendorans who ever served on the Mount San Antonio College Advisory Board, and that was the foundation of the Mount SAC Foundation, which now exists, and that's a pretty special honor. I could go into so many more things, but let me draw my attention, if I may, just to a few more personal things. Joe and Ida have a very special relationship. Many of you know that they've been married for over 37 years. What you may not be aware of is that they were both raised in a town in New York, in the Catskill Mountain area, and the name of the town is Liberty. Now, you heard that mentioned tonight when we welcomed her mother here this evening with us. Have you ever noticed Liberty publications on their publications? That's the significance of that name. And I suppose that was true with your Liberty Bell column as well in the Glendora Press. Now that
middle name is Bell.
And her middle name is Bell, so there you have it. Liberty Bell, right here. Liberty is not one of your larger cities. Never has it had a population exceeding 5,000, even today. These people were bound to meet. But what happened was, Joe was bowling with Ida's dad. And one afternoon or evening, Ida kind of sauntered into that bowling alley, and she was a senior in high school at the time. Joe looked at her and he said, "This is the woman for me." He threw a gutter ball. And honestly, for him, it was love at first sight. And I think that it's so suitable that you had that song sung for you, for Ida tonight, the Crazy About Ida, because that you said you were absolutely nuts. She was dating some muscle-bound bodybuilder at the time. But, like Ben. And Joe knew he didn't have the physical prowess to meet his match, so instead he said he outsmarted him. Well, Joe and Ida started dating, and they'd only been dating a month when Joe was in a very serious motorcycle accident. And quite frankly, he was lying in the hospital, and he was so seriously close to death that the Catholic priest was there giving him his last rites. And even though he had only known Ida for a month, and this is so special, she was the only person he asked for. He'd only known her a month. He knew he wanted her for the rest of his life. And he said to the priest, "Bring me Ida Steinberg." Talk about it. Boy. But he did. And of course, Ida was there at his side. And I'm sure it was her love for him as well that helped him to get through that very, very difficult time. And it obviously started a foundation of love that has provided for much, much growth and just such fulfillment over their years together. I would just like to say that anyone who has spent any time with Ida and Joe know that they are very, very giving people. And I think everyone has said that tonight, and I don't need to belabor it other than to say that our community is so very much blessed with these kinds of people who bring to this community the service that we are so well known for in Glendora. And I don't think there are two more deserving people. I was saying to my husband, Lauren, that if you'd only done the Glendoran magazine and nothing more, I would want to stand here tonight and give you the honor as Citizens of the Year, because that in itself is a legacy that we will all appreciate throughout our continued history in this city. But you've done so much more. And when we talk about you being the wind beneath her wings, you certainly have been that. But both of you have been the heroes. You're Glendora's heroes. And we honor you tonight. Thank you.
Well, Joe and Ida, I'm here representing Glendora Kwani Anns, and I would like all our Kwani Ann friends out here to stand up tonight, because we would like to give this to you. Come on, everyone, please stand up. Kwani Ann. Yeah, really. Two dear people, very special people, Joe and Ida. We would like to present to you, in your honor, a $100 donation to the Ida's Club from the Kwani Anns. We love you very much.
Thanks, Kathy. Have a long name. That's Kathy Napoli. We have a change in program here. Next is Georgia Lee Hawthorne from the Bloomers Garden Club, Georgia Lee. And then Mary Hannah. Is it Hannah? Is that right? Mary Hannah, Glendora Women's Club.
I have to read this. I can't do it any other way. Dear Ida, tonight you and Joe are our honored friends. The garden club you brought into existence some 17 years ago blooms on. I haven't decided whether we're late bloomers or early bloomers. The 20 of us you so aptly named the Bloomers learn about flower arranging and gardening. Your home and yard, as always, is an inspiration to us all. The quote from Alexander Pope seems to be written about you. Where'er you tread, the blushing flowers shall rise, and all things flourish where you turn your eyes. Would the members of the Garden Club stand up? We have some here. Kathy? No, Ben, you stay seated. And I'm a Democrat, too.
Oh. Damn, I like the garden.
Ida, to you with our love from all of us in the Bloomers.
Hi, Ida and Joe, the Glendora Women's Club wanted to join in the festivities in congratulating you and thanking you. Ida has been our historian, And if you all are aware, much mentioned tonight, the Glendora magazine, the recent story, which took many, many hours, much material to be dug up. They did the most wonderful part of Glendora's history, a story on the Glendora Women's Club. From we're 64 years old right now, and no, 84. 84. And we'd like to give you this little token of our esteem and congratulations. Thank you very much for all your work. And P.S. on my own, I'm the fifth Democrat.
Georgia, you're a sweetheart. Boy, there were a lot of closet Democrats until this evening. Huh? Incredible. You know why we couldn't hold the club? See, Joe and Ida wanted to start a Democratic club. Is that right, Ida? And so they called this meeting in the community Democratic. So three people showed up. The three of us. I'm not going to be president. Why should I show up anymore? It's going to be 2-1 no matter how. With these two, the vote would probably end up 13-1, if you know what I mean. You know, it's interesting, Joe, I didn't know. That was touching, Molly, about the motorcycle accident thing. That was, you didn't finish it, however. He was a member of the Hells Angels. That you should be aware of, all right? And what, just think, he didn't tell the end of the story. When the priest heard, please, I'd like, you know, Ida Steinberg to come to my side. Joe recovered, they buried the priest 6 days later, and he was a pallbearer. Okay? You can make him romantic, Molly, but please finish it, babe. I know the whole story. I told Joe and I, if we could conclude, I said it to Everett and I've said it to Orv and each year that we've come together, if we can conclude by 10:30, it's a miracle, and especially with the tremendous number of people who want to speak and honor. Last year I received a letter after the banquet saying, Mr. Bollinger, you're the biggest jerk. The lady came up and wanted to just walk up and say something. And I very kindly, in my typical Ben Bollinger style, said, gee, I don't think that's a good idea. I didn't do it that way exactly, but she didn't speak. That lady doesn't like me anymore, and I don't care. Tonight, thank you for not wanting to come up and speak. But I do know for a fact that everyone sitting here tonight would love to have the opportunity to tell Joe and Ida how much they mean to them. And I would suggest to you that if you look at the rundown in the program, each year, whenever it was Citizen of the Year, we sat down, went through the order, and when Orv went through it, different things changed in order to be able to share with you the lives of these people. And this is the first year I've seen where Ida and Joe really did not want the Citizen of the Year trophy given at this moment and respond, but they wanted to respond after, they wanted to receive the trophy earlier, then respond to all of those who have come to give their plaudits this evening. I say to both of you, and I'm sure I'm speaking for our community, each year we honor very, very wonderful people. But this year is a very, very special time, and I would like for you at this time, before they respond, to stand and let them know how much they mean to this community. Thank you.
Be able to respond or not. Ben said, you going to respond? I said, I think so. Well, simply stated, I'd just like to say, wow. You know, this has been an e-ticket ride for Ida and I all night. You guys have just been fabulous. It's kind of better than even receiving an Oscar, Ida, I think. You know, tonight's a particularly emotional time for Ida and I for many reasons, and we decided at this point in time in the evening that probably everything that could be said would be said, and what wasn't said probably shouldn't be said anyway. Besides, I lost the coin flip. Sorry about that. Let me say in the beginning that we're grateful to Ben, as you probably all are, for a lovely evening. We understand his schedule as being so crazy, and for him to take on the task of Master of Ceremonies for us tonight is very meaningful to us. We really appreciate him, and at the risk of sounding a little patronizing, I'd like to say if anybody in Glendora deserves perhaps to receive the Citizen of the Year twice. I think Ben Volunteer would be the guy I'd vote for.
Well, it's the last time you'll be at a center table.
You know, the fact that Ben agreed to MC this evening knowing that he was our second choice shows that he's even a bigger man and really very generous. I really do. Well, you know, some of you might look confused about this, but let me explain to you. You see, we asked our friend Jack Pallett if he would co-MC, and he said he'd love to, but he said he only had one routine, and it had already been overexposed at the Academy Awards. And besides, he said he couldn't say the same thing about Ben as he did about Billy Crystal. Well, you know, I'll tell you, tonight's a perfect night for a party. Probably like most of you, having a party after April 15th, you know, tax time, we probably all can use a party. You know, they say that March goes out like a lamb, and then in April we all get fleeced, and I think this is what happens. But, I don't know, I'll tell you, I think the income tax has made more liars out of Americans than golf, Ben, you know, really. I'm serious. I lied on my tax return again this year. I put myself down as head of household. I finally have it figured out, though. My accountant is also my therapist. It works out. No, it works out great. He shows me how to cheat at my taxes, and then he helps me deal with the guilt afterwards. And, you know, and then what about the economy? You know, we should all be grateful for organizations like our Chamber of Commerce for trying to stimulate business. I'm serious about that. Only last year, the merchants in Glendora had signs out reading "Help Wanted." This year, it just says "Help." The president, and I'm a Democrat, I'm not ashamed to say it, as Ben admitted tonight, you know, the president keeps telling us that recovery is just around the corner. You know, this from a man who works in an Oval Office. Seriously, it is truly humbling to be before you this evening. For Ida and I to have had our names merely submitted for this honor is self-thrilling. But to be chosen and included in the same company as distinguished past citizens such as Ben and Bob O'Dell, Jim Vincent, Orv Mested, F. Hughes, Ruth Harper, Guy Williams, the Ludwigs, the Andrews, Norm Nichols, to mention just a few, it is overwhelming for us. Before going any further, Ida and I would like to offer appreciation to the Glendora Chamber who made this evening possible. To Glendora Chamber Director Pat Henney and her staff for their outstanding and to Steve Wormsley and Grant for our thanks for their excellent accommodations. I think we all had a wonderful meal and for hosting our pre-dinner cocktail party. Our thanks to Joe Nava and the members of the Citizen of the Year Selection Committee for their excellent choice. To Glendora Kiwanis, Kiwanians, Friends of the Library, Historical Society, and the IDAS for submitting our names for consideration. Ida and I humbly thank each of you. Thanks to our special friends, Pat Bushman, Culver Heaton, Connie Tiffany, Sharon Meyer, Isabel Stokes, Don Hitt, and Molly McLeod, who have taken the time from their busy schedules to speak very kindly about us and very candidly, I must say. And to everyone who made the many presentations to us, and again to our Mr. Wonderful friend Ben Bollinger and each of the fabulous citrus singers, I wish we were here to hear it. They made this a particularly enjoyable event for all of us, and we thank you. We thank you. Just going to make a few brief statements and get you guys out of here. I know you're probably tired. When I was a child, I remember my grandmother admonishing me to always do my best because she said you can fool some of the people some of the time, but you can't fool all the people all the time. The fact that Ida and I are here being honored tonight shows that that's not necessarily always true. Ida once told me in private, she said, don't people know that I do what I do for selfish reasons? And I cringed, not believing my ears. And she continued, don't they understand that when I see positive things accomplished, people helped, and projects completed, that I feel good and I enjoy it, and that's why I do it. It was then I realized what she meant. As all of you who know Ida know, she's about the most honest and uncomplicated person you'll ever meet. I realized that while to many the word selfish might appear to be a negative, it's not always true. To Ida and the many others who volunteer like her, it means love. Their self-satisfaction of seeing a negative turn into a positive, a wrong righted, and a need met is the very core of what makes volunteerism such a workable necessity in our community and our country. So perhaps we fooled you into honoring us tonight, because you see, we've been receiving honored rewards all along the way. You've already met our family. We have three great children, of whom we're very proud. Ida and I feel very fortunate to have weathered those traumatic growing up years and to be able today to enjoy their successes, their families, and our six grandchildren. The night wouldn't have been the same without you guys. Did you know that? I can't let this opportunity pass without saying something about a very special lady in our life, Ida's mother and my mother-in-law. And as you heard before, she was the inspiration for Ida's founding of the Ida's Club over 15 years ago because of her courageous adjustment to her blindness. I always tease and tell everyone I have the ideal mother-in-law. She can't see anything wrong with me, she can't hear anything wrong about me, and she lives 3,000 miles away. But I love her dearly. No one receives this wonderful and coveted title, Citizen of the Year, without worrying about teamwork, without pulling together. It's the team that makes things happen. It's the team that gets the work accomplished. It's the team that keeps on going and does the impossible. When you and I want to quit, we think about not letting the team down and try even harder. Ida and I were blessed and learned early in our marriage that the load gets much lighter and the job gets done much quicker by pulling together. You've heard about the saying of opposites attracting. We must be a classic example. Ida is an excellent organizer and expediter, as you've heard. She can get the impossible task done. She's an extrovert. She loves being around groups of people, but she's also a warrior. On the other hand, I'm an idea type person, a born procrastinator, and probably one of her lifelong challenges. I'm more of an introvert, however, I'm a born optimist. Somehow, together, we complement each other's strengths and weaknesses and find ourselves not only being able to be very productive, but also enjoying our busyness together. We really are each other's best friends. From Ida, I've learned about appreciating the simple things in life, appreciation of nature, flowers, birds, about people, friendships, and art. I've learned the meaning of integrity, loyalty, compassion, and giving. I gotta hesitate for a second. Ev and Orv, I bet these guys $20 a piece that I wasn't gonna get emotional. And they said, you will, and you're right. Some of us are fortunate that sometime during our lifetime we get to meet someone with a charismatic personality, someone whom we immediately recognize as being above the norm, someone that has something special to offer. I was even more fortunate than just meeting such a person. I got to marry her. I'd like at this time to introduce the other and the best half of our team, the Citizen of the Year every year in our home, my partner, my wife, my best friend, and the real reason we're all here this evening. like to just say one more thing. As each of you, by your presence, honors us tonight, we would like to acknowledge your part as extensions of our volunteerism in Glendora. We're both proud and happy that you could be with us tonight to share this moment in time that belongs as much to all of you as it does to Ida and me. You're wonderful, and we thank you.
Thank you very much, Joe, and I think you'll enjoy being Master of Ceremonies next year. I thought the speech actually sounded better when I wrote it, but you came a long way with this speech, Joe. Thought you were a little long-winded, Ida. Well, again, it's been a wonderful evening. You're such a fabulous group each year as we fill the room with many of the same faces and different faces. I just know that it's important that we realize the effort that's given not only by the honorees, but by Pat, the chamber, that this becomes one of our gala events in Glendora each year. I thank the recipients, but I certainly thank all of you for making it such a very special event. I've been asked to please tell you that the announcements regarding the table flowers, the Citizen of the Year committee members are invited to take the flower arrangements with them. Our thanks for the excellent teamwork. Leave the table markers and $100 bills in an envelope marked Ben Bollinger. Thank you very much. Good night, ladies and gentlemen. We love it. Thank you.